How's everyone feeling about the weeks ahead? There's about 3.5 weeks, or just over 3.5 weeks to go. Sally, how are you feeling?
Look, I'm feeling very energised, looking forward to it. Very cautious of how the communities are feeling and the division and all of that sort of stuff, and how everyone's dealing with certain comments. But just looking forward to getting through this process and, you know, being with Mob and talking.
Natasha?
Very similar. We're very aware that, you know, this has been very divisive in communities. We're just waiting to see what's on the other side of it, I think, for both, yes and no and in between. We're just waiting to see what's on the other side of it and what we can do after that, I suppose.
Charlie?
It's going to create history for all of us here in Australia, that for the first time in this country that the First Nations people is going to be included in the Australian Constitution.
Tanya?
Very focused on how much work there is to do if we're going to have any chance of success. It's a huge responsibility for those of us who are active in the campaign. Whatever side of the debate you sit on, there's so many conversations to have, and we've just got to be so incredibly focused. But, you know, as other panellists are saying, we need to start being reflective now about how we respond to the outcome the day after the vote.
South Australia, a state of real first. Natasha, South Australia has a very politically engaged First Nations community. Why do you think that is? And it's been happening for generations, and regardless of what side of the debate you sit on, it's really, we've been standing on the shoulders of giants in this state for a long time, haven't we?
Yeah, we have. We've got numerous warriors in our community who have fought very hard over generations, like you said, and have taught people like me, who's nearly 40, to help take up that fight for them. They're getting very, you know, they're elderly now. Mm. They don't want to see us doing this and our kids continuing to do this, but they're very inspirational and educational on how to teach our kids and young people how to stand up in the right way instead of being really radical about it. And there's nothing wrong with being radical. You've just got to pick and choose how you do that, I says.
It's about seeking change.
Do you think that we'd be in this position of having the referendum without their activism and advocacy?
Probably not. There's two sides to that. There's people who are for change and people who are for sovereignty. So those two parties have been fighting very strongly back here, and without them, both of those groups, without them, we probably wouldn't be having conversations around these subjects.
You know, so. I think resistance movements play an incredibly important part of the conversation. And so, you know, I think one of the things that I've been pleased to see is the respect that has been shown. I think media has highlighted where there's been some unfortunate, you know, instances of disrespect, but actually largely I have found really productive conversations that really speak to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander aspirations, but understanding that there's different parts that make a movement whole. Mm. And, you know, I think we should all be proud of the fact that there are people prepared to stand in places that can be very difficult in the midst of such important nation-building conversations.
Uncle Charlie, on the weekend, to see so many people turn out for the walk in the centre of Adelaide, what was that feeling like to see so many people turn out?
Enormous amount of inspiration. What made me so excited is that majority of the participants were of non-Aboriginal descent, and that's fantastic. You know, walking with these people together and yelling and screaming, you know, what do we want? Nothing less but yes. And also see the people walking along the footpath and standing on the footpath taking photos and waving the Aboriginal flag and taking, and also clapping and so on, and giving us a lot of encouragement. I mean, you know, that sends a very strong message that here in South Australia that we have got a process whereby that we have achieved a lot of opportunities for the vulnerable in Australia. And I'd like to think that South Australia, we nailed it.
Tanya, I want to go back a few weeks ago. You spoke at the launch of the Yes campaign here in Adelaide and you mentioned openly about your health challenges. How are you feeling and are you optimistic about South Australia's chances in this campaign as we enter those final weeks?
Yeah, thank you. I'm feeling pretty well, but it's certainly going to be a long, frustrating journey to walking again, hopefully. But having said that, you have to remain optimistic. If we ever thought because something was hard that change wasn't possible, we wouldn't be here today. Change has only ever been possible because people have been determined to pursue it. And, you know, I think the turnout that we saw in Adelaide, recognising that as a state, you know, we definitely count in that double majority. I hope that South Australia holds that long tradition of being, you know, progressive as we have been. We've been fortunate over the years to have progressive leadership, strong leadership from community and some from, and also from some political leaders along the way. So I feel optimistic, I feel determined, and I feel like there's not a moment to waste. We certainly can't take the outcome for granted, but what I feel assured of was that there's plenty of other Australians who feel similarly.
Tanya, you've been in the movement as a leader in the Recognise campaign since 2012 and Sally, you've been in the movement long before the Uluru Statement from the Heart. What was it for you that wanted you to be involved in the movement?
I think I think for all of us as Aboriginal people, when you growing up, you see your elders stepping up. You see that show of leadership, you know, and I was very fortunate to grow up with some really strong, incredible women. You know, I went to the dialogue at Ross River, which was incredible. Sitting in that room in Ross River with all the mob who've had to deal with intervention and that conversation, there was also big conversations around the loss of community control, you know, loss of communities having a voice. And these were members of the communities who were already feeling voiceless and they wanted to change that. And that was amazing to be a part of. And as a young person, we're not really at those tables of conversations. And, you know, what was amazing about the Ross River dialogue as well is we were speaking in different languages. You had four translators talking to mob of comfortable and talking and engaging in all those different ways. And you know, I remember that space of hope as well, going, don't Aussies want to know us? Doesn't this country want to know us? Know our history, the good, the bad and the ugly, but know it from us, not through a different lens. And it was incredible. And so for me, it was, really took that charge and worked with my communities and, you know, got it to Uluru. And
Natasha, we're talking about voices, different aspects of voices and different platforms of being activists or raising you know, our points of view, both on the national and international stage. You're doing that on different platforms through movies. How important is that to bring that to international communities about the things that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people want to say and want to tell the world?
Oh, it's extremely important. I think the history of our Indigenous films here in this country, we show a lot of trauma. We show a lot of dark history of what we do, what has been done to us. A lot of those films, you know, they reach overseas, they eventually do, but they don't get pumped out like everything else. So being the oldest storytellers on the planet, I think we really utilise that as much as we can. But I'd like to see some more films about the way we're living now. I've made a point of trying to break out of the historical dispossession stories and traumatic stories because I want our people to see us strong, as strong warrior people that we are, especially in our own land. I think that's really important to show us in that light, that strength, just as much as showing our history.
I think one of the strongest images I know of you, Natasha, is at the rallies for, or the vigils for Cassius Turvey, yes. Standing at the front there. It was really fierce and that's a very memorable image of you. Thank you for that.
Family for us, from my mum's side. But even using, you know, I was raised on Point Pierce Mission, one of the oldest missions here in South Australia, in the country. And my dad told me, when you get older, get a respectful job, come back and help your people. Mm. And that's what I'm doing. I'm trying to use the platform as an actor to shed light on what we're dealing with right now. And I understand that my position on all this voice stuff, you know, I'm the only no person here, am I? Yep. Yeah. I'm the only person sitting here representing sovereignty and the other side of the no campaign, because I realise that that has been hijacked massively. And you spoke about the rally you had on Saturday. If, you know, I held a grassroots event here, 20 people came. Mm. And I've got to make this point. It doesn't matter how many people rock up at any protest. It's about being heard. So whether there was one there, 20 there or 2,000, it doesn't matter. The other point I want to make is the no campaign has so much funding. Grassroots haven't gotten $1. I've had to pull out my own money out of my own pocket, me and my daughter's money, to put on events for aunties here. Aunties that are 60 to 80 years old, and they're not getting heard. So I'm sitting here for them today.
You want the same outcomes, though, wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely.
We all want to close the gap. Yeah. So what's your solution?
My whole stance on this is, as less than 3% of the population, I don't think it's right that just over 97% of non-Indigenous Australians are going to vote on us. I think that's racist. I think it's not respectable, considering everything we've gone through as a people in this country. So I'm really happy that you guys asked me to come here today, because I've been getting a lot of heat in community, which we all know we're going to deal with that, good and bad, it happens. But I just wanted to sit here and have a respectful conversation with you guys, because I think that's what we're lacking right now.
Yeah, and I think that's very important. We can disagree, or we can come at the solution from different angles, but we've all got to come together. We've all got to sit at the kitchen table, because we've all got to get past the vote day.
And it affects all of us.
Absolutely.
And if it was just Indigenous people voting, I would not have a problem, because that's us voting on our mob and our futures, and that's self-determination to me.
Uncle Charlie, did you want to say something?
You know, working in Aboriginal Affairs for well over 50 years now, I've actually been subject to at least a minimum of 10, maybe 12 policies that government has introduced to try to close the gap for Aboriginal people. The only problem with those policies is that whether it's the state government or the federal government, like the Labor Party or the Liberal Party, whoever goes into government can actually wipe those policies by the stroke of the pen. So when we, as the ones who are supposed to be receiving those policies, when we get used to it, then all of a sudden it's been thrown out. Mm. So in other words, how can you close the gap for Aboriginal people when you continue introducing new policies after new policies? And so Aboriginal people, we can't get used to that.
And that's the status quo that we're sitting in, is that, you know, as Uncle Charlie's saying, like, these policies are introduced, we have to work our way and fit into that model and then figure out what that looks like for our communities. And we all know that when it's a policy or when it's a program or a company or something from mob, that mob start, it flourishes. It continues to flourish because it's a mob buy-in in that way where, you know, and for me, like, why I want us to be in the Constitution, why I want that, you know, it's this document that was done without women. It was done without Aboriginal people because they thought that we were going to die out. And it was done in a way to never change it because they wanted to keep their status quo. They wanted to... Those men wanted to protect it, and that's why, you know, it's so difficult with the referendums with that double majority, because they never wanted it to change. They never wanted this old document, 100 and something years old document, to change at all. And we have to get all Australians to go get involved in this, because it's about our responsibilities, all of us. Mm. And for us to sit there at that table when that policies are being done actually saying to those ministers, hey, minister, that's not going to work in our community. Mm-hmm. You know, that idea from Cape York might not work down in, you know, far west coast. That idea for Kimberley mob might not work down, you know, at Noongar or, mm-hmm. you know, APY. Like, there is so many stupid policies that happen where we're not involved in. Imagine if we were involved, the times that we have led through, the times when we have asked to be involved in things and we know that the outcome's better. And all, like, you know, how many times have we heard those arguments of, oh, Aboriginal people get so much money. That's not actually hitting the communities. It's getting stuck. It's also getting stuck with the different messages as well. And so it's, for me, I look forward to that opportunities of our communities saying to Canberra, this is what we want to see. And also advising those ministers and saying no. And if they choose not to hear the voice, well, we can quite publicly say we've advised the minister on these policies to go this way. They've chosen to do it their own self. That's the blame's all on them.
I trust the advisory board if it actually made changes. That's my other issue with what they're offering, that they just have to hear us. We have been screaming, yelling, crying, doing drastic things to get the government to listen. Why do we have to go to their table? Why can't they come and sit at ours? Why can't we have our sovereignty recognised as First Nations people and have them come and sit with us? Why do we got to go to the big buildings all the time? That's not self-governance. That's falling under somebody else's law when we've got our own laws here. Like you're very strong with your culture, sis. You know, Uncle, you are too. We all are. But why can't they come to us and sit with us? Why do we have to keep going back to them?
Natasha, if you were able to elect a member of your community to represent you, would that give you confidence that you'd be listened to?
Not really. I know that my elders stand in their sovereignty pretty strong and they've been fighting that for the better part of most of their lives. So I don't think that they fought for an advisory panel without power. I know that they fought for real change and they're still fighting as 60 and 80-year-old elders out on the street now for that. So I would like the government to come and sit with us and sit at our table as sovereign people, as First Nations people, and respect our law, acknowledge that. If they did that a long time ago, we probably wouldn't be sitting here like this right now, to be honest.
One of our most respected thought leaders, Professor Marcia Langton, has come under sustained attack when she was misquoted in the media and accused of calling no voters racist, causing a media storm. Uncle Charlie, there's no doubt that there's been a big spike in racism during the campaign. Would you agree that accusing someone of racism is being portrayed as a worse crime than actually being racist?
To put it simple, I think she's been misquoted. She hasn't... I don't think so that statement was actually directed to the Australian population. It was only directed at certain elements of, you know, people that are actually pushing the no campaign. And unfortunately that here in our society that newspapers, news reporters, they tend to take advantage of negative comments and they interpret it wrong. Yeah, look, Marcia, she's a professor and she's been in this game for many, many years. And she knows exactly what she was talking about. And she knows exactly who are her audience. And I am 100% sure that she didn't say a statement like that to know for a fact that there's going to be a backlash from the media and from the community to be able to interpret that she's saying the wrong thing.
Tanya, there's quite a distinction, isn't there, between calling elements of a campaign racist than calling no voters racist?
Yeah, absolutely. We know that there are a lot of undecided voters out there still, and there are going to be no voters. Some of those no voters are going to be Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. And so to accuse them of being racist is clearly going to be completely inaccurate. But I think what we need to do is remember this is another tactic to take us away from the main conversation right now. We know that racism exists. We also know that people don't want to have the conversation about that. But the conversation we're trying to have at the moment is one where we're trying to grasp an opportunity as a country. We have one of the hardest constitutions in the world to change. And, you know, Natasha outlaid, you know, some of the things that, you know, are challenging about that for us. But that is the only way to change the constitution, is getting that double majority. And that's the conversation we need to focus on, and not allow those people out there who really want to make mischief with people speaking truths and, you know, really driving us away from a conversation that is going to lead us to have to vote. 17 million people in a little over 3 weeks are going to have to make a decision at the polls, and we're going to have to live by that decision. And so what I say is, let's get back on track.
Yeah, Sally, let's talk about some of the other tactics. They've been described as Trump-style misinformation, throwing confusion at it. So we talk exactly what Tanya said about everything but the question at hand, the amendment in the Constitution. Do you see similarities in your personal experience with what we've seen in America to what we're seeing here now?
Yeah, I mean, the media tactics at game, like, you know, when we look at the Marcia's comment, that was talked about because in that morning we found out that No Campaign is literally telling their volunteers, don't say where you're from, you know, just say you have a concern. That comes out in the morning, that the tactics of the No Campaign to feed fear, to say use fear, use that feelings of fear to confuse these people that they're ringing. By lunchtime, we're seeing this whole thing around Marcia, and it's a week later and we're talking about that, how her experience and what that happened.
Of the people who have been platformed recently, the leading No campaigner, Warren Mundine, was on the ABC at the weekend stating that treaties would be more likely with a no vote rather than a yes vote. The shadow Indigenous Affairs spokesperson, Senator Jacinta Numbajimpa-Price, who we've also invited multiple times on the show, has also made headlines.
Do you believe the history of colonisation continues to have an impact on some Indigenous Australians?
No. I'll be honest with you, no, I don't think so. A positive impact, absolutely. I mean, now we've got running water, we've got readily available food.
Would you accept that there have been generations of trauma as a result of that history?
Well, I guess that would mean that those of us whose ancestors were dispossessed of their own country and brought here in chains as convicts are also suffering from intergenerational trauma. So I should be doubly suffering from intergenerational trauma.
Uncle Charlie, when you heard Senator Price make those comments that there were no ongoing impacts of colonisation, what were your first thoughts?
I think it would be a direct insult to the Wurundjeri people, no doubt about it. And that would have sent a shockwave throughout Australia to other First Nations people, all right? And if I may, here's a map of Australia. All the massacres that have taken place since 1788 and 1930. One massacre happened up in the Flinders Ranges where my mum and dad was born. And luckily they weren't there, or my ancestors weren't there, otherwise I wouldn't be sitting there today, all right? But in Port Augusta, back there in 2008, 9 and 10, we had many young people, you know, dying as a result of suicide. So there was a report conducted, all right? And what the report found is that prior to 1788, that our culture was, the fire was burning bright. All right, but since 1788, that fire has disappeared, all right? And the saddest part about it is that the blood of our ancestors are crying from the land, and as a result of that, our young people, from a psychological point of view, they find it very difficult to manage that. You know, how can we actually, you know, live and work together here in this country when we know for a fact that our First Nations people, the oldest living culture in the world, 65,000 of years, that's still not recognised in this country.